I'm Luke Steels and I'm a research professor in artificial intelligence. I've been working in this field for many, many years, doing robotics and language and, you know, all the things that are exciting about AI. You know, in AI there have been many trends. And lately there has been a very strong trend associated with machine learning. And machine learning, the dominant paradigm is that you have a lot of data. It's called big data, a lot. And then you run certain algorithms over this. Some of them are inspired by neural networks. And then you derive a system that then solves a particular kind of problem. So this is called a data-centered view on AI, which is can give powerful results. But there are some problems with it, and they are related to, let's say, the human relationship. So I'll give an example. If for a credit card, you know, suddenly you want to pay and they tell you no, your credit card is not valid. You're surprised. And then it turns out they say, well, if you say why, they say, well, we have this system, and this system has been trained with millions and millions of data from credit card use. And then it turns out that some action you want to do happens to be something that looks suspicious from the viewpoint of this model, right? The statistical model. But I mean, if you never did anything wrong, you say, well, you know, why can I not use my credit card? And so this is, if you take that point of view, that means you worry about the human aspect, the ethical and legal issues. You put the human, let's say, in the loop, in the sense that the human is used as a model or as the source of knowledge, maybe in addition to lots of data, but you want the human element, let's say, to be dominant. And then it's a trend, because it's not like black and white, you know, but so human-centered means to make sure that the human remains at the center of this technology. For us humans, meaning is central to what we do. We always look for meaning. Even if something doesn't have a meaning, you know, we still look for it, because this is what makes us human, actually. Now, a machine doesn't do that. A machine doesn't have the emotions, the moral compass, the experiences that humans have, and maybe they will never have it. And so when we talk about understanding, we talk about getting a situation and interpreting it in terms of all these meanings, like not just factual meanings, but also the intentions. What are the goals of the people in the scene? You know, what are their mood and so on? And so the understanding is like creating a narrative, we say. You could say a story from a situation in which all the pieces fall together. And if you have that, then you can predict what's going to happen. You can answer questions about the situation. You can, see how it might change, or how you might do things differently. I mean, there are lots of things which you can do when you understand a situation. And so in the data-centric AI, there is no understanding. It's basically patterns, statistical patterns, and then you apply them to the new situation. You know, but understanding is more than that. Even if you are fixing some problem in your house with the water, you know, or some device that doesn't work, you should first try to understand the problem and then fix it. You know, not just start doing things or do something in which in the past you used to do and then it worked, you know, but now there's a different problem, you see. So this is the bottleneck, this is the glass ceiling of current AI systems, you know, that they don't even try to get, well, I mean the data-centric AI, even they don't even try to get to the meanings. It is quite clear that we get a lot of experiences from the world, from being in the world, interacting with the world. But it's also very clear that for us humans, language is enormously important. You know, because a lot of knowledge is conveyed through language. And language is like a symbolic medium. It's not the only symbolic medium, because pictures or drawings or photography or, you know, they're also to some extent symbolic. But language is an incredibly powerful way in which we can convey and also in which we can coordinate the way we see reality. Because if I say, this is a black dress, you know, and then you may talk with a fashion designer and she would say, no, this is not black. This is whatever particular kind of black. And maybe there's even an argument that she might say it's blue, you know. So the even the colors that we have are influenced by our language, how we talk about it. And you see big differences in cultures, how they talk about the world, the words, of course, that they use, but the conceptualizations also of reality to be able to talk. And this is also a point in our project. We do not assume that everybody sees the world the same way. And so this is, we know there are differences between different cultures. You know, some cultures, they don't talk about left and right, for example. They talk about towards the sea and towards the mountain. You know, and maybe in Venice you might do that. You might say, we go seawards, you know? But they say it, they sit in the room at the table, and instead of saying the fork left of the plate, they say the fork towards the sea of the plate. You see, so this is another way to conceptualize. And so language is a primary vehicle for conveying information and coordinating how we see reality, and also encouraging others to make concepts, you know, because if you learn a language, you also learn the concepts that the people speaking that language find important. So the main thing about human-centric AI is that we want to avoid situations in which a human is kind of dominated by a machine. And I'll give you an example for legal issues, social legal issues, you know. You're in prison and, well, of course you want to get out. And so you can ask for parole, which means that you can get out earlier. Okay, now usually there's a judge and he will look at the situation. In fact, he will construct a narrative of why are you here. He will talk with you to know what are you thinking about, how will you go back to society. But there are also data-centric AI systems that pretend to be able to predict whether somebody is going to commit a crime again. And then they look at statistical data of all the prisoners and what they did when they were on parole, you know, and based on that they will make a decision. Now, can you imagine? Because the difficulty is that this data-centric AI is a black box. You know, it's inside. There are millions of parameters that have the result from training. You have no idea what is going on. Even the designers of the system, they cannot tell you what the basis is of the decision. You cannot ask for an explanation. Now, I think, and my colleagues, you know, who are into this human-centric AI, we think that this is unacceptable. And I gave the example of parole, but the credit card, you know, decisions on a credit card, or you want social housing, or even you send your CV for getting a job interview. Now, there are now many data-centric AI systems that are used by big companies to filter the CV based on patterns which you don't know, which actually they don't know. But can you imagine? I mean, this is dehumanizing. And I think I'm personally very opposed to that kind of thing. This is not what we should use AI for. And so now you could say, we don't want to throw away the baby with the bathwater, right? So we want to keep also good things about AI. So we have to create AI so that it's good for us. I mean, it would be like a car on the road and it's killing people. I say, well, you know, you use the car. Yes, you get forward, you get where you want to be, but you killed 5 people on the road. This is unacceptable, right? So also for AI technology, yes, the idea is good, is interesting. It can help society. It can help particularly deal with the complexity of society, you know, because we have many people now, highly complex society. But it should be done in a way in which the human remains respected as a person. And again, this means that you look at, you try to understand. When you make a decision, you try to understand. And this is what we expect from a judge or from somebody looking at your CV, you know, or any other thing that you could imagine where a decision support system might get involved. So when we were writing the proposal, we were thinking about possible applications. And the cooking domain came up. And one of the ones is that, you know, when people get older, they often like to remain independent. And they like to cook. But they also can be absent-minded. Begin to forget things, you know, or have physical problems. And so the application that we have in mind is to help people who have problems with memory. You don't have to be old to have problems with memory, of course, but to so that they can live longer, you know, a joyful life. And cooking is one of the aspects that make life enjoyable. So that's, I think, now you can imagine other things, like in terms of productivity of kitchens and all of that. But for me, this is an example where we can help humans, the memory capacities of humans, which deteriorate with age. You know, even if you're not yet with dementia, I mean, there's already, so that's the how we hope to help. And we do that not by replacing the human, but by empowering the human, you know, by giving somebody more tools or help that you can continue to be independent. In society at the moment, we are getting more and more in trouble, you might say. And social media is one of the causes. And why is it? Because, you know, conspiracy theories, fake news, manipulation is happening and on a grand scale, and we don't know it. And unfortunately, I have to say that AI algorithms are playing a big role to make this possible. And so this is another reason why, you know, I insist on human-centric AI, because the algorithms that are underlying, let's say, Twitter, Facebook, all of them, you know, is they want to keep you on their platform. And the algorithms, right? Of course, the company, they earn more money if they keep you on their platform. So they optimize what they present to you so that you would stay. And they learn that. It is not programmed. It's not that there's somebody looking, oh, You know, Lorenzo looks a lot at pictures of dogs. Ah, I'm going to give more dogs. No, it's totally learned by these kinds of data-centric algorithms, particularly reinforcement learning, you know, and deep learning, these kinds of things. And these algorithms have no clue about the content. They don't know whether it's a lie or it's the truth. You know, they just focus on propagating more. Well, they don't focus on propagating more, they focus on keeping you on the platform. But as a consequence, this fake news and all this kind of stuff propagates in society. And so in the you can use human-centric AI also for this, you know, to have another kind of AI. And so the for example, it would mean that the, you know, these algorithms, which, given that there are millions of tweets every minute, right, you cannot expect humans to sit there controlling everything. So that they are, you need algorithms, but the algorithms have to take into account meaning, what these tweets are about, you know, and you cannot just filter on keywords. You have irony or a joke, or and so that's one reason why with human-centric AI we hope to be able to well, not completely, but at least to get to more meaningful ways of recommending or of filtering, you know. So to keep the sanity of the internet discourse.